Hi. Hi, everybody. Hi, it's me, Jennifer, from Little Metal Foxes. And we have had a bunch of requests to talk about pen finishers. So I have my pen finisher here. I use one at work at Baleen. And I am loving using them. They're good for a lot of things. But I wanted to talk about the pros and the cons of working with a pen finisher. Here we go. And I've got... from London, so here she comes, and we will talk to Helen. Let's see if we can get her on here. Hey there.
Hello.
Hey, sister. How are you doing?
I'm good. How are you?
Doing all right. So we've had a lot of requests lately about the pen finishers and how they work, what they do, why they're leaving black sludge on things, why they're not working on their stuff, what they're good for, and so on. So I wanted to touch base really quickly on what these guys are great for. The magnetic pen finishers are a little bit different than the other tumblers, and different tumblers are great for different things. We've got, you know, the vibratory tumbler I use for a lot of stuff. I've got it right back there. And rotary tumblers are good for things. And the prices can vary quite a lot. So with a rotary tumbler, it's slower, and you usually can pick one up, a little rock tumbler style, for, you know, a few bucks at a garage sale or at like Harbor Freight or someplace that's that has like little rock tumblers. And you don't need a fancy one, but you can use like steel shot in it. And it usually takes a day or so for things to run. So it's
Julia's here if you want to add her.
Oh, she is. Oh, let's see. Yeah, let's add Julia. Let's see.
Yeah, because I was actually watching a dice maker, you know, like for D&D, and they had a tumbler of sorts that they used wood blocks instead of like ceramic or steel or metal media to do the tumbling. I thought that was really cool.
Yeah, actually we use...
Good morning, Julia.
Hi, good morning. So using different media like wood, all kinds of different shell, corn cob, all those things are great for polishing dry. They're dry materials. Usually when you're working with like ceramic media, plastics, or steel, you're usually working wet. And those are, like I said, they're good for like vibratory tumblers and for rotary tumblers. But what I want to focus on this morning is pen finishers. So, hey there, Julia. Hi.
Joining us in the dark.
No power.
It's mood lighting.
You can see me from the window.
Oh my gosh. So yeah, it's very windy here. Oh my gosh.
Yeah, it's very windy.
Magnetic pen finishers. Anyway, getting back to the cost of this. So usually like the rotary tumblers are going to be very inexpensive and very accessible. They work great on lots of things. They're a little bit better at the controversial issue of work hardening things while they're in there, because you have more of the repeated pieces hitting as they're falling. The the vibratory tumbler and the magnetic pen finisher, they really, all of these things, all the vibratory tumblers and pen finishers and tumblers, basically they're smoothing the surface down, they're compressing the surface, so they don't do a whole lot of actual work hardening. It's very controversial because some people are like, oh yeah, it does a great job, it hardens everything. I'm like, great, good for you. But other people are like, nope, doesn't work.
So science says it doesn't work.
Science says no, but some people are like, sure, yeah, it works great for me. So whatever works for you, go for it. So with the vibratory tumblers, you usually can pick one up for, the prices range depending on how big you get one and if it's flow through with water or, you know, whatever, but they can range from, you know, $100 to, you know, several hundred bucks, depending on, you know.
The super basic one that I have, which is like the Raytech Tumble Vibe, which is a 5 pound.
Is
the cheapest one, and it's in the $70-$80 range, but it's not a flow through.
Mine's not a flow through either. And I got mine, from E.B. Fittler many years ago, and it's nice because I use a ton of different materials in there, and I use it wet, I use it dry, and it's great. And I think it was a couple of hundred bucks for mine. It's a little bit bigger than than the tiniest one.
Yeah, but I do chain in mine, so it, you know, chains conform really well. And this is actually an issue for if you're doing cuffs or bigger things, you have to have a tumbler that's big enough for them to move around in, which is probably, you know, you were doing castings, like your cuttlefish casting, so it has to be a bigger bowl if you have larger objects. If it's something like a chain that bends easily, it can fit into one of those 5 pounders, no problem.
Yeah, and you do want to be careful anytime you're putting chain into a tumbler, because if it's such a delicate chain, it will tangle. So you have to have ways to like keep it from like either by wrapping it up on a spool of some sort or, you know, hooking it together in a way that it's not going to get tangled. But yeah, larger chains that are linked in a way that they don't like, there's no way to tie them in knots. Those are fine.
Which is kind of the kind of stuff I make. So it's less of an issue for me.
There's Michelle. Hi, Michelle. The pin finisher, though, let's talk about this, because this is the thing that
I
think is really baffling to a lot of people. I've been using one for a long time at a lot of different places, and they seem like absolute magic, and they can be really good, but the pros and cons here are you've got pros and cons with every single one of these.
Right.
The pros with this
is that it's not
going
to do everything for you.
Right. And it's not perfect for everything. And, you know, because a lot of people want to throw everything in there and have this magic shine come out. And it just doesn't happen that way with a magnetic pen finisher. You can do that better with something like the rotary polisher or the vibratory polisher. But for bigger pieces. For smaller things, when you have batches of things or, you know, little studs and earrings and links and, you know, smaller stuff, you can get a lot done with the pin finisher. So the pros are that it's fast. It takes maybe 20 minutes in the pin finisher to run a cycle versus 2 hours in a vibratory tumbler or potentially 2 days in the rotary tumbler. So it really exponentially speeds up the amount of time that you can get things done. And especially on really delicate things that are like filigree or little things that have lots of little nooks and crannies that are extremely difficult to get with a traditional polishing method. So it, because all the little pins fit in and burnish all the surfaces. So it usually will give you a high shine. The one of the things that's important to note about all of the finishers is that the media you put in there, especially the steel pins for something like the pin finisher, which is the only media you can put in here, have a breaking in period. And a lot of people don't understand that. So with the ceramic media and the vibratory tumbler, it takes days to break that in. And you just have to let it run, run and rinse. And you've got to get that sludge out of there to get it broken in. And the same is true with the magnetic pin finisher. You've got to run it with a with some chunks of stuff in there for, you know, several hours to get those pins broken in so that the clipped
end. You're kind of blunting the pins, aren't you?
You're blunting the pins, because they're clipped. They're steel clipped pins. And so they have like a little sharp edge. So for perfectly flat, shiny surfaces, the pin finisher may not be your best option, especially at first, because it's going to like ding, 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 ding with all those little steel pins. So it does take a lot of breaking in to get the pins smoothed down on the ends. So that's thing one, you have to break in the media. And with the pin finishers, they are a little bit more expensive. This one that I have before me is nice because it's relatively small, which is nice because I can set it on the counter and lightweight. I can put it away if I, you know, don't want it around.
I can see the little cup isn't very big. It's like, you know, just like a big coffee mug, basically.
It's not too terribly big. And with any of the pin finishers, you want the pieces to be able to sit on the bottom. If they can't sit on the bottom, the pins can't reach them. So it's not going to be effective in polishing them. So if you've got bigger pieces, you're going to need
in there. It's only going to polish the bottom edge.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. Or like a heavy cast ring. It's just going to like blah, 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 around the bottom. So you can turn it over if maybe, but it's not going to get in all the nooks and crannies. It should be able to sit on the bottom comfortably and be able to tumble with media for it to actually polish the pieces. But because the pins aren't attached to anything and they're being drug around by magnets, you don't have a lot of actual friction and force that's being applied to the pieces for things, especially like filigree. So it can float through and around pieces like that that are delicate, get inside of things like, you know, hollowed out rings and little nooks and crannies of texture without like breaking it up, you know, or without doing a whole lot of damage. So this can be a really great way to get a high shine real fast on delicate small parts. If you, you know, and this, like I said, is about $350. The larger ones are significantly more expensive. One size up from this, going from a 4-inch to a 6-inch or 4-inch to, yeah, a 6-inch, the price doubles.
Wow.
And if you're getting one of the big, big ones, they're thousands of dollars. The other thing that can reduce the cost on the pin finishers is if it doesn't have the variable speed, it's going to be usually a lot less expensive. It's going to be a couple $100 less expensive. So you can get one without the variable speed that they're going to be less expensive, and you just turn it on, turn it off, and your speed is the same. With some of the bigger ones, they usually will, you can program it so it'll run for a particular amount of time, and you can program it to reverse direction so that everything spins around for, you know, 5 minutes, and then it stops and then switches directions. This causes everything to flip in the bowl and go around, so you get things like flipping and tumbling as it goes. So so these can be, you know, really affordable on a small scale, but be aware that you can't put like a bangle in there that's, you know, a wide cuff and expect it to finish it. It's just not going to do that. But for my stuff, for my pin, my, you know, studs, for hoops, for, you know, charms, for, you know, all kinds of smaller stuff that are, you know, especially cast pieces, it's great for that kind of stuff. I've had a lot of people that are interested in sticking their cast pieces in there and trying to break up the investment. Don't do that, because that is an abrasive that's suddenly sitting against your shiny, shiny pins, and it will wear the pins down. So don't put anything in there that is got any kind of abrasive material on it, like investment. Make sure your investment
don't
for
put
cast,
anything dirty in it. There
don't put
no
anything dirty in it.
Or,
no,
yeah,
no.
Dirty in it.
And
this isn't
grease,
for cleaning. It's not for cleaning. It's not
it
an ultrasonic.
Absolutely not. Absolutely not for cleaning. It's not for breaking down your investment. It is for adding a absolutely beautiful high shine to a surface. And if you're putting grit in there, it's going to potentially mess up your pins, and you're going to end up getting like a scratchy surface on everything.
Yes.
So it's not for that. So make sure any investment, any compounds, anything like that, that you've got like for polishing is completely cleaned off, and using something like a little ultrasonic with this de-investment material in there that can shake everything loose is going to be really helpful. But keep the pins clean and you're going to get a high shine all the time. Then the next thing about this is the water level. It has like a little water level on here, so you want to fill it to the minimum water level at least. And there are different compound burnishing solutions that you can use to help give the pins some slip. And you'd be doing this with any, usually, of your wet media. You're going to be adding like a little bit of a wet lubricant to the water to help it spin and burnish a little more smoothly. Usually, I'm using something like Dawn, just a drop. Boop. I mean, literally like the tiniest drop. And it just adds enough slip. And a little bit of like water softener sometimes can help. Rio has a really nice powder that works really well, and I believe it's like a water softener. And you can use a burnishing compound solution that's great. It's a non-sudsing agent that adds that lubrication to the pins. Then anytime that stuff looks dirty because it's taking oxides off the surface of your metal, you want to make sure that you're rinsing the bowl regularly. So after every couple of runs, I will make sure my water is rinsed out and changed so that it doesn't get dirty and build up those oxides on the pins. That does happen. And if you're doing something like anything that's brass or bronze, that's going to happen really quickly. And you've got to get that zinc and tin and stuff off the pins, or you're going to get this like black sludge that appears, and it looks like
the black sludge,
and it looks like black graphite-y sludge. It's almost mm-hmm. greasy. That's in the tumbler. So what you need to do is you can either use the like Rio's steel shot cleaner and run it around with the steel shot cleaner. Sometimes people will end up getting that stuff. It'll redeposit all those oxides onto your piece. And so the pieces come out looking like really gray and greasy. And so you can actually run them with the shot cleaner and it'll strip all that stuff off really quickly. And just rinse everything off. The other option for the black sludge, because it does build up, and it's like sometimes it'll happen really suddenly. It's like everything's suddenly covered in black sludge. That's the time to catch it. Or if you see it starting to get a little dull or gray, run some steel shot cleaner in with your pins, and that will take care of the problem. Yes.
Do you recommend using Coca-Cola for that? Because
yes,
I know there are a lot of people who
do. I love using Coca-Cola. Yeah. So Coca-Cola has phosphoric acid in it that is will strip that that material right off the pins. So I'll usually use just regular Coca-Cola and water 50-50 and run it for a cycle or two, and then rinse the pins with soap and water for another 20 minutes or so.
Yeah, you want to get all the sugar and other stuff that's in the Coke
right
out of it.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. So otherwise you end up with little fat pins.
Yeah, we exactly all know how, you know. Yeah.
Exactly. So you can use Diet Coke. Diet Coke will keep those pins nice and thin. No.
Thin. No, you still got to get the aspartame and stuff out of it.
Yeah, yeah. Using citric acid to clean the steel shot sometimes can work, but I got to tell you, why spend money on citric acid when you could just go and get a Coke? Dump half of it in and you're good. Drink the other half and you're happy. Some for you, some for your pen finisher. But the best thing that I have found, honestly, is just steel shot cleaner. And it doesn't take but like for this amount. Usually you can dilute the pen finisher in a gallon container, and like a couple of tablespoons in a gallon container. And it does not take much. Like literally like less than a capful will clean the shot really well. So that is usually what I would recommend for that black sludge.
Jennifer, do you recommend using distilled water to put into the pen finisher? I know here in Seattle, we have pretty nice water that isn't super hard. It doesn't have a lot of minerals in it, but
yes,
super hard here in London.
Yeah. So in some places, and not only for my, I'll use it for my flux. I'll use it for my pickle sometimes. So it just, it depends on where you are and your water quality. If you've got a lot of minerals in your water, use, either filtered distilled water or something that is going to take those things out. So, I mean, if you've got like a Brita filter or something that you can, run your tap water through, if it's got a lot of stuff in it, that will take care of most of it. But yeah, absolutely. And it's, if you've got a lot of iron in your water and you're running with magnetic pen finishers, iron, magnets, all that stuff like does weird things on your pieces. So, anytime
you don't want to pound all those little particles of iron or other stuff into your piece either, right?
Right. So
I don't actually have a pin finisher, so I don't know.
Yeah. Like I said, I think some people buy them thinking they're going to be the silver bullet finish for everything they need. Yeah. And they are for certain things. I at work, we do a lot of mass finishing, for pieces. And I'm finishing, 50 pieces at a time in something this big, and which is great. I mean, they're like little hoops and little studs and things like that. I can throw
tiny
them.
Tiny little things that would be annoying as F to buff.
Absolutely. So I can get all that polishing for like 50 pieces done in 20 minutes. So it is magic for that stuff. For the bigger cuffs and stuff, you're going to have to use something bigger and either hand polish or use a larger machine to do that. The other thing that when I've got tiny stick studs or tiny little post, the pins, I'll show you, are not very big, but here we go. Let me pull out a few. So there's a finger full of pins. They're very tiny, but if you've got tiny studs in there too, they can be the devil to get out. When you've got like separate 50 stick studs in with a bunch of pins. It's like, so a magnet. And they do make like a magnetic little gun thing that like sucks up all the magnets and helps you separate it. That thing's expensive. Just get a good, you know, strong
cow like, magnet.
This is a cow magnet. And mm-hmm. yeah, so I've attracted every cow within 30 miles of Seattle. but cow magnets.
People don't know why cows have to have magnets, right? And
yes.
actually, most cows are not grass-fed anymore in fields with barbed wire. So
yeah.
they don't actually even need them.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So these were usually like you bloop down the cow's
right.
gullet, and it would collect any like barbed wire or things
staple,
that it would collect.
Stuff that yeah. the cow accidentally ate.
Exactly.
Right.
Yeah. Things that it would accidentally ingest, and it would grab it in the first stomach and keep it from passing through their entire system and tearing it apart
right.
from the inside out. So cow magnets, you know, and then some of them would use over and over again.
Well, no, because they stay in the stomach, right? Like you dose your cow with the cow magnet, and then, you know, the cow and the cow magnet are now a thing. They're a unit.
Yeah, they're symbiotic.
It's,
yes.
And so it stays
you can take
in
your
there,
cow,
grab
you can take your cow and stick it to the refrigerator, and you know.
Yeah. Who are the instructors like, get out of here. No, for reals. I grew up in a dairy farm, you know?
These are good. So, but they're very strong, and it's nice because they're a good size. But get a magnet, and that way you can run the magnet around, and it will pick up your pins, and you can separate it from your pieces. So it makes it real easy just to sort of take them off, put your pins, you know, in one dish and your parts in another. And if you get little pieces stuck in your filigree or your little details, a magnet or a little, sometimes you have to have a little tweezer to pull those parts out. But yeah, pin finishers are fantastic. They, you know, they do have some pros and cons. But if you're doing something with tiny stuff, delicate stuff, things that are like a pain in the ass to polish and get a high shine on, this can be a great solution and save you an enormous amount of time. And for like $350, I mean, it pays for itself if you're doing things like a lot of shows and
a
lot of stuff.
If you're doing production, if you're doing production and you're making tiny things.
Yeah. Yeah. So,
know,
I mean, if you're doing,
wonder why you didn't get it before, even though it cost you
absolutely. So for, you know, like Michelle and other people out there that do delicate, small work, this will take all that finishing time off your hands, and make it a little bit easier for you to get things done more quickly, for the small stuff. For the bigger stuff, you might need, you know, another way to do it. But I have found for things like filigree and small parts and castings and that kind of thing, it's absolutely brilliant. And small fabricated parts, it's really good. Like I said, I can finish up to, you know, like at least 50 little studs at a time, if not more. And
little tiny annoying things.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. So yeah, I've thrown, you know, 100 little tiny studs in here at a time, and they come out 20 minutes later and they're perfect. So
and
but
she
it
swirls
is,
her cow magnet into her little cup of tea and pulls
like,
out her little
pocus. Pocus.
Yep. And then
all my
it's
little
so
stuff.
Efficient.
Yeah. So it is much, much faster. It's, you know, 20 minutes instead of 2 hours with a vibratory finisher. So you really are.
Well, it depends on the tumbler. Like, I don't actually run stuff that long in mine.
Yeah.
You know, I can get a nice shine on my chains in like half an hour.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
But my polishing medium, I use the porcelain, the little porcelain. They look like little straight rods, right, with the diagonally cut ends. But
right.
you do have to break that stuff in, and that takes a week. You have to run it literally day and night for a week. You don't have to rinse it in between. You just get a really bad black sludge at the end.
But
you have to run it for a whole 7 days, because otherwise it'll do what the pin finisher does. It'll leave little micro scratches on your piece because it's sharp. Right, you know, when they're new,
right?
So, and most medium has to be broken in. This is like the big, you know, secret that people don't get when they buy a tumbler.
Right. Yeah.
Well, let me ask too: is it because someone asked about tumbling being slower? I'm guessing because the actual mechanical action of the tumbler is slower than the pin finisher, because pin finishers go pretty fast. Is that
different? Oh yeah. Yeah.
Or part of the
different... vibratory tumbler, and that one goes pretty quickly too.
They do. And that's what I was saying. The rotary tumblers can take, you know, a day. I'm just tossing out. It doesn't necessarily, not everybody puts it in there for that long, but I mean, it can take 2 days for some things to finish properly. If you're deburring it, you know, after casting, you know, that can take a little bit longer. And then
you're cutting away material. So that makes sense that would take longer as opposed to just smoothing the surface.
Yeah. But getting a high shine, I mean, some people will use steel shot. Some people like to use, you know, compound enriched materials like the
walnut
cubes,
shell.
Yeah. Walnut shell, the corn cob, you know, that kind of thing. So you can get like sunshine material that'll buff stuff up. But for the pin finisher, I love it. It's great for stuff like this, and I would highly recommend it. But like I said, it's not for everybody, and it's not for every situation, you know. But if you're really frustrated by the amount of time that you're spending polishing the tiny stinking little parts that you've got to do for the show coming up, this is going to save you hours and hours and hours and hours just on one batch. So it's just
which will cut down your time, which will cut down your overhead, which will cut down the cost that you have to ask for the piece.
Exactly.
Which means you can sell more because you're able to sell them for a lower price.
And
so,
you can make more much
faster. Yes, exactly.
Okay. Well, that's it for today. And because I've got to go teach a class, but, pin finishers, check them out. And we've got the rolling mill class coming up this weekend. So if you're interested in getting a rolling mill, please stop in. If you're like, so how do I get my pin finisher to be broken in? Stick in a bunch of chunks of scrap metal and let it run for several hours. Michelle, do that. And just let it run, let it run, let it run. And it beats those pins into submission. But just let it run while you're like not paying any attention and just in the background and just let it go. And that will definitely help to break those pins in. But it does take some time. And it's not, like I said, it's not great on flat surfaces. So if you've got stuff that's not flat or cast pieces, you can run that stuff. But for the flat parts, you do want to make sure it's broken in or you are going to get some, it won't hurt the motor. That's what it's designed for. It's an industrial tool. So there you go.
Nice job.
Yeah. So, I mean, it goes through, mine has a timer, so it'll run for like an hour, and then I can rinse it out and run it for an hour and rinse it out. And we run ours at work all day long. So, they're good. Okay, so I'm off to teach. Rolling mill class coming up, lots of good stuff coming up. Check out our website, and you can find this on YouTube, and all of our great tool tips are there. So I will see you guys next week on Tuesday. Bye.
Bye.